Well, thank you for joining us today for our Employability in the 21st Century workshop. Thank you to our employers who will be sharing their knowledge with us today. I'd like to start by introducing President Denson to give us a few welcome words. Thanks, President Denson.
Thank you and welcome. Happy Monday to everybody. And I want to start by thanking our business partners for being here. Many of you are all DMAC students, I guess. The important thing to know is that when you leave DMAC, you will have the technical skills and ability to do whatever you wanted to do. I mean, you will have exposure to those skills, be able to learn those skills, and be ready to be employed. We've heard from employers for years that, yes, it's one thing to have the technical skills, but then there's also those soft skills, which we call employability skills, that will not only help you keep your job, but it will help you be a success. And many of them are simple things like showing up on time, working hard. So the part of this series is we want every student who leaves DMAC to have a good comprehensive list of all those things you should do in order to be a success, because there's never been a better time to be an Iowan and never a better time to go to work in Iowa than there is right now. I mean, employers, they're growing, they're successful. Wages have come up over the last few years that they're, very competitive to anywhere in the country. So what we want to do is make sure that anyone that leaves DMAC is successful, not only for you, but successful for the company. As I say, there is a secret of life. A secret of life is hard work. And you'll find that some people are lucky. Most of us have to work hard. And the harder you work, you'll find the lucky you get. So thank you all for being here, choosing to come. And we really do appreciate you being DMAC students. So thank you very much.
All right, just a little bit to get us started. So according to a Glassdoor study, an average cost of hiring an employee is about $4,000. So hiring employees is one of the most important investments that a business can make. And employers want their employees to be successful. So we're starting from that viewpoint. Last year, a DMAC leadership group surveyed several local employers who hire DMAC graduates in a variety of fields to determine what skills they see as most necessary and in need of development for their new hires. And employability skills rose to the top of that list. These skills included taking initiative, communication skills, problem solving, and adaptability. As you prepare to enter the workforce, DMAC is training you with the technical skills and the academic knowledge you need for your industries of choice. But as President Denson said, we also want to assure we're helping you consider the employability skills that can help you thrive and grow in your industry. So today we're lucky enough to be joined by four employers from a variety of industries, and they'll share their insight about these employability skills that lead to employee success, from getting the job to growing within the organization. So I'm going to start off with our first question for you. Could you please introduce yourself and your role at your company and give us a brief history of your career path?
Hi, I'm Barb Offsa, and I'm a recruiter at Unity Point Health Des Moines. I've been with the organization for almost 38 years. I started out as a communications supervisor, and I moved to human resources, worked in benefits for a short period, about a year and a half, and then I moved into the business partner role and did a blend of recruitment and employee relations, moved into employee relations solely, and now I'm back in recruitment and enjoying it.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Kenny Kyle. I am with TMC Transportation Logistics. We are a locally based operation with facilities around the country and in various locations. I am currently the Vice President of Campus Collaboration, which means I get to do things like this pretty much every day. If I'm not teaching in a classroom in a university somewhere in the country, then I'm on a student panel or doing some sort of presentation to a club or whatever, which job I very much enjoy doing. I'm here to represent TMC and basically create interest in our company by showing the quality of the company and the things that we offer. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Grace Swanson, and I work at Acumold, which is a plastic micro-injection molder over in Ankeny. We've been in business since 1985, and I am the vice president of human capital, which means I take care of safety and recruiting and employee development and community relations. It's a very exciting job. I started my career before all of you were born. And at that time, there was a lot of press that engineering degrees were going to be obsolete by the time you graduated. And being cheap and paying for my own college, I couldn't see spending all that money and having my degree obsolete. And I came across a quotation that said, "Children do not respect their parents." And it was Socrates. And I thought, wow, if nothing has changed in 2,000 years, I'd be pretty safe getting a degree in applied behavioral science. And so that's what I did. I started my career as a social worker, came home one night and had rice with chocolate syrup on it for dinner and said, oh, I love this job, but it just doesn't pay enough. And I ended up in business and have spent my career in manufacturing in very different, very exciting roles.
Good afternoon. I'm Abby Olson, and I'm with the state of Iowa. My career actually started at Hy-Vee. So I started when I was in college with no intent to stay with the company and ended up spending 24 years there. So I worked my way up. I was a store director for 6 years, and then I moved into our corporate office where I was director of recruiting and hiring. And then they disbanded that department. So I moved back to being a store director and then decided that I wanted to take a different path in my career. And so took a step back. And about 10 months ago, I decided that I was ready for a change. And so was looking for other opportunities, and that landed me at the state of Iowa. And so my current role is I'm the executive branch recruiting coordinator. So obviously the state of Iowa is very large, lots of different branches, lots of different agencies. And so that's where I am now. I miss people. That's how I ended up in recruiting. So.
Okay, thank you for your introduction. So I'm going to open it up to start with to some of the questions that might be in the audience, and we'll have you come up front, right? Okay. I'll pass this.
Here?
Yeah.
How's it going, guys? My name is Noni Keo. I'm in video production at DMACC. And I have a question for everyone up here. Could you just provide us with some examples of what leadership looks like in your company?
I think our expectations of leaders in our organization, it kind of starts by building relationships with the staff and helping develop them in their current position and hopefully developing them into other positions that they may want to move into. I think that those are some pretty pretty basic expectations, I think.
Yeah, if I could add there. So leadership, you know, rather than management, you want to lead your people, lead them by example, lead them by being humble. So if you want to be a good leader, first of all, be humble, right? And I know that back in my earlier stages of management, I was not humble and I was not a good leader. And I learned by errors that I made. If you want to retain people, and you already spoke about the cost of hiring people, really retaining people is far better than hiring. So you want to look after your people. You want to treat them with respect. You want to remember that their whole life doesn't exist at work, in the office, in the shop, wherever they're working. You know, they've got things going on at home, outside of work, that might be affecting what they're thinking, what they're doing. So just treat everybody as a human being, treat everybody with respect as you would wish to be treated. And I think what people are looking for as well is encouragement. And I'm not talking about gold stars or participation trophies, but give people credit for what they've done. If you're a leader and you're leading people and someone does something that's a fantastic idea and you want to take that idea on and move it up the company, make sure that that person who came up with the idea gets the credit for it. So if you're the leader, you're leading and you're being successful by producing great people to be the future leaders. And I always used to remember, I used to interview people and say to people, I hope one day that you'll be my boss, right? And I really meant it. I think I'm too old for that now, right? I'm going to retire soon, so.
I'll just echo off of Kenny's point. I mean, really, as a leader, it's not necessarily about you. It's about those under you and those around you and bringing them up. Because if they look good, right, they make you look good. and so it's giving them the opportunity to continue to grow and to continue to move up and to pursue their dreams.
Thank you.
I would certainly agree. If you can help your employees find a way that they love coming to work every day, that's a great gift that a leader can give to an employee. That, you know, this is what helps them solve their passion. And I think the other skill that a leader needs to have is, if it's not their passion, helping them find what is. And it may or may not be at your company. And I think that's really critical.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Max Williams. This is year two for video production for me, and my question is, do you look beyond the transcript and consider volunteering or community service experience?
Well, I can answer that. We look at all that you put on your resume and all that you share with us. We also do pre-employment screening. So we'll have you fill out a survey that gives us some insight into your strengths and how you approach problems. We want to make sure that this person that's coming to our company is really going to be a contributor.
Thank you.
I would say for this, the state of Iowa is a little bit different because we have what's called minimum qualifications. And so in order to be considered for employment, you have to meet those minimum qualifications, right? That said, once you meet those minimum qualifications, it's all of those other things that you mentioned that are really going to shine through in the interview. And, you know, on the resume, if I'm looking at, you know, a couple resumes and I've got one that has no volunteer or no internships or anything like that versus one that does, I'm going to, you know, say to myself, hey, this person really has gone out there, has, you know, tried to learn and expand themselves, even maybe without some of that specific employment experience.
Thank you.
And I would, just to expand on that, I would agree with that. And certainly it's something that we would look at in the overall picture. It shows initiative. It shows that you have drive and want to learn more, and certainly things that we're looking for.
Yeah, just to add there, you know, if you're volunteering, then obviously you've got great ethics and you're putting in more effort than you need to go to a certain place. And of course that helps. Everything looks good that way. So, yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Hello. How do you create environments that make problem solving and collaboration feel like a safe activity to engage in?
Well, I can start. So at Acumold, we do not make any of our own parts. Everything we make is the customer's design, and then we make the steel mold, much like a Play-Doh mold, only a million times more sophisticated, to create that part. And most of the parts that we make a grain of salt look chubby. So we're in the very small, precise niche in the market. And so it is not at all uncommon for us to have a launch for a new product for the customer, where we have the design engineer who's going to design the mold. We have the tool maker that will make it. We'll have the quality person that will measure it. We'll have the processing engineer that will figure out the temperatures and timing for the plastic. And it starts with, why did you take this order? we can't make this. We absolutely can't make this. What were you thinking? 2 hours of arguing later, it's, okay, well, if we do it this way and we bring the plastic in here and we tilt it when we make it, then we can make it. And so creating a culture where that arguing is a part of the creative process has been a key to our success.
Just a quick example in our organization, I would say we do daily huddles in departments. And that's an opportunity to bring up maybe opportunities, how we might be able to enhance something, trying to encourage ideas and initiatives to be brought forward.
You know, safety comes first with absolutely everything that comes ahead of profitability. You know, creating a safe environment for everyone to be in is huge. We're a transportation company, but we look at, you know, safety comes for absolutely everybody, whether it's students interning in our offices, whether it's our drivers who are out on the road, whether it's our mechanics in our shops, or someone washing trucks in the wash bay. You know, safety has got to come first. So we have processes in place for absolutely everything. And people, let me give you some examples. A driver, we do flatbed mostly work. So a driver out to load a truck goes to a customer, and the customer loads the flatbed and then puts the tarps up on top of the load, and then tells the driver, you can't put the tarps over the load while you're in our yard here. You need to pull outside in the street and do it outside in the street. So what's the customer saying at that point? It's saying, we don't want to take responsibility. And it's also saying to us, we don't care, right? And we will not accept that. And we will make that customer unload the product again, and we'll never go back to that customer again. That's how seriously we take the safety. And that goes right across the board. Like I say, if you're interning in an office and you're dispatching a truck or selling or something like that for brokerage, you make a mistake, it might cost the company a few dollars. If you're a driver out there on the road and you make a mistake, it might cost you your life or someone else their life. So it's hugely important.
I would say it's just creating an open environment where people feel respected and encouraged to bring their ideas forward, but also from a leadership perspective, you know, being open to those ideas and practicing what you preach, right? If I say, hey, I want to hear your ideas, come see me, and then you come see me and I'm like, oh, I don't think that'll work, right? You're probably not going to come back and bring me another idea. So really being open to those ideas and following through with them. You know, if somebody comes and says, hey, I think we should try this, you know, I'm probably gonna go back to them and say, okay, let's work together on this, or you know what, I'm gonna put it back on you to take some responsibility for your idea. But then following back up with them to, you know, let them know, you know, what the next steps are or what we can do.
All right, thank you.
Hey. What resources or strategies would you recommend for expanding your soft skills?
Your soft skills, I mean, it adds up to an awful lot, of course, right, for anything. So you go to a career fair, you want to be the person that's noticed, and you want to get to the next stage of having an interview. You get to the interview, you want to be offered the position. So how do you go about that? And then when you get the job and you get into the job, then what do you do to be noticed? Because, of course, you want to keep moving up in the company and you want to be appreciated for what you do. So all kind of good questions. So one thing that I say, that the very first step, say you're going to a career fair and you're going to approach companies to then maybe go on, do an internship or go for a job, is how you approach people. And so first of all, how you're dressed. If you go to a career fair, you know, dress appropriately. If you're approaching people, do it with confidence. If you're going to a company, especially if you get to the stage where you're going for an interview, know something about that company. Don't just glance at their website for 30 seconds on your phone before you walk in the door. Spend a good hour going through their website, write notes down. If you go for an interview, take a nice notepad with you or whatever with some questions on it to ask, and even some notes about the company, it's quite okay to do that. And really, knowledge and interest, and show that you're really interested, will take you up that point scale quite considerably. Turning up professionally dressed as well for a job. I guess it depends on the job that you're going after, right? You know, you're not going to wear a suit, you know, to go and get a job at McDonald's or something like that in the evening. But if you're going to go for an internship in a company where you're going to be working in a professional office, go dressed appropriately for that. Have questions with you for sure as well.
Just a couple things to think about. Maybe asking for feedback, ask people for feedback. What soft skills do I need to improve? And then maybe figure out ways that you can go about improving them, or ask for ideas, accept feedback. Another thing I would just maybe say is there's something called Strengths Finder. And that's something that can help you identify what you're strong in and maybe what you could maybe work on, and maybe being able to identify what those things are and be able to kind of work on them and improve in those areas.
Keep learning, you know, pick up books, watch YouTube, watch TED Talks, you know, more than ever before in history, there are people out there willing to tell you good ways to improve your soft skills and bad ways to improve your soft skills. So I would say keep learning.
Yeah, I would say just put yourself in those situations, right? If you can volunteer or do internships or even just a regular job, right? I mean, I learned a lot of my soft skills as a cashier at Hy-Vee, having to talk to random people and dealing with people in retail. Those of you that have done that understand. but putting yourself in those situations. Also, networking is a great way. I mean, all of those people that you know that you're comfortable with, you know, talk to them. And see, you know, what advice they have. You probably have a variety of people in different fields, and they're probably all looking for something a little bit different. And then, you know, finding that mentor that's not afraid to give critical feedback and help you to improve.
Thank you. I'm Savannah Blaylock. I'm in the nursing program here. And my question is, every new employee wants to be a success. What are the key things your employees do that lead you to promote them? And what are the key things your employees do that lead you to terminating them?
Yeah,
I'll start with that one. Well, the first thing is, I would say every day on a job, right, is a job interview. So a positive attitude that comes through every single day, being dependable, doing what you say you're going to do, and then being there when you say you're going to be there. And just communication. Cannot say what it, I mean, communication, whether it's verbal or nonverbal or written, like it all makes a big difference.
I would add to her comment about communication is always start with the man in the mirror, as Michael Jackson said. Communication, it's critical, it's hard, and it's not about you. And so when you go into a situation, you know, think about how it's set up. What are the other people in that room? And even if you don't know them, what is it that you need to get across?
Great ideas. One thing I might add, is maybe volunteering or taking initiative. If there's an opportunity to be involved in a committee or an activity or a team that's working on a project, volunteer, learn something new. Those are going to be key to helping you move forward. And I think on the other end, when you talk about like a termination, I think that varies a lot, just depending, you know, not following what the expectations are of the organization, probably.
Yeah, if I could add a couple of things to great comments we've had so far, I would say think about people that you've worked with who you have not enjoyed working with, and what are the things that they did then don't do them. Okay. that would be one. And you know, what happens when you make a mistake as well? And if you're going to be in nursing, you probably don't want to make too many mistakes, right? And don't make mistakes if I'm your patient. But, you know, in different occupations and different cases, people make mistakes, right? It's, you know, we're humans, we make errors. So if you make a mistake, then how do you fix it? So first of all, you tell somebody that you made the mistake, your supervisor, and say, I've made a mistake here. What can we do to put this right? My cases, mostly it was with customers where we did something to mess up and didn't provide the service to the customer that we should have done. So how do we put it right? And we put it right by being as transparent as possible about it. So if you're nursing, don't mess up. Just do it right every time. But if you do mess up, immediately own up to it and say, I made a mistake here. What can we do to put it right? And that shows integrity.
I'm Madison, and I'm in the nursing program. And I was wondering if you could provide advice on staying motivated at the workplace when faced with challenges.
I guess being in healthcare, one thing that I would say is a way to stay motivated is to think about your place in the big picture. You know, what you're doing right now and how that's helping that individual, that patient that you're caring for, and how overall you're making a difference in the organization and in the community.
Yeah, I agree. You want to feel that you're making a difference, right? You want to feel that you're important, and you are. Everybody is. Everybody has that place where they fit in and become a part of everything that's going on. And staying motivated through challenges, it can be difficult, but look at where you want to be, where you're going to, and make sure that you give yourself credit for the things that you're doing as well, and you know, realize that what you're doing is important and it's making a difference in helping others.
And I think gratitude has a lot to do with joy at work. I always remind myself, and everyone can have their different perspective on this, but God blesses me with work. And there are people right now praying for what you have, even though it may not be what you want to end up with. So having a grateful heart as you go into each day and realize, as he said, you're making a difference. You're meant to be here and you're going to change the world in a different way than someone else will.
I would say one is just don't get hung up in the things that you can't change. Right? I mean, there's some things that it's going to be the way that it is. And so, you know, changing the things that you can and letting go of the things that you can't. I think remembering the why is really important, as that was stated. And then I also think just creating a good support system, right? Some days work's going to be tough. And some days work's going to be boring. And some days it's going to be fun and joyful. But having that support system, whether it's inside work or outside, is really, really helpful.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Margarita, and I am going into the Medical Lab Technology program. And my question is, how can I demonstrate that I possess soft skills during my interview and application process?
And I did kind of touch on this a little bit earlier on, right? You know, you want to show, you're going to go for an interview, you want the job that you want. I always say to everybody, you go to an interview, one thing to take to the interview with you are a lot of questions, and have at least four or five questions, good questions that you've thought of beforehand, because it may be that the person who's interviewing you will address some of those questions during the interview and talk about them. So if you only have one question to ask them and they talk about that for 10 minutes during the interview, you go, oh, what am I going to ask them now? So make sure you got some questions to take with you when you go for an interview. Be interested, listen to what the interviewer is saying to you, and don't be so focused on what you're going to ask next that you're not listening to the information that's being given back to you about the company. And ask about the company. Ask all the questions that you want to know, because it may be that you don't really want that job and you might want to go and work somewhere else as well. So do all your research, dress nicely for the job, and go there. Be professional. Be confident in yourself. You've gone through all this schooling to learn the job. You can do the job. Let them know that you can do the job.
One thing that I would say is we do a lot of behavioral-based questions. And so we're going to ask questions and ask you to tell us about a time that you displayed something. And so that gives you an opportunity to showcase your soft skills. So, for example, we might ask, tell me about a time when you relied on someone else in order to be successful. And so you'll want to have an idea of maybe some specific scenarios that have happened. And this would be one where you would talk about teamwork, where you worked with somebody else in order to be successful, take care of the patient, that type of thing.
Yeah, I would say those examples are really helpful. Reading the job description, right, is going to kind of give you insight into what kind of examples they're going to ask for, right? If it says that, you know, you need experience with data analysis, what are some things that you've done that revolve around that? Or you need somebody that's detail oriented. What have you done that's, you know, attention to detail? So those specific examples are really helpful.
And be prepared for difficult to discuss or even undiscussable issues where they may ask you, have you ever had a problem with a supervisor? How did you handle that? And sharing a positive way that you solved that problem will give us as the interviewer some confidence that you really have developed good soft skills. Attendance, all of those kinds of things you can get into a conversation with employers, and it'll leave a positive impression. Now, if you go to the interview and you're mad because it's not a place you want to work, that's going to come screaming out. You know, my mother made me interview here, right? My uncle works here. Do what brings you joy.
Thank you.
I'm Sophie. I'm in the history. And my question for you is, what aspects of communication skills are most valuable for your company?
Well, for me, I would say working together as a team. So being able to communicate what the issues are, what are the solutions, and being respectful of everybody on the team. So you're solving this problem together.
Yeah, I would agree. I think we have what we call focus values. I won't necessarily go into those, but they're about teamwork, respect, empathy, kind of all of those things. Just making sure that you're working together as a team, and the people that you're working with, your customers, your patients, that you're respecting them and, you know, having empathy, trying to understand where they're at.
I think you summed it up there. Like teamwork is how do you work with other people in an amicable way where you're showing respect to them, but you get the job done and you still get the opportunity to put in your ideas, your vision as you're working through things. So you you know, and I've asked this a lot of times in interviewing people, especially students, right, where, you know, if you have a group project or whatever in school and you end up, you know, working in a team, are you the team leader some of the time, most of the time, hardly ever? Or do people tend to lean towards you to be the team leader? Are you a natural leader from that way from a team? And it's okay to be the leader, and it's okay to be a part of the team that's not the leader. There's no right or wrong answer to that as well, but it might be something to prepare yourself for as well, a question on that. But working together, respecting everybody, I mean, that's huge.
Just one more thing I would add. One of the things that really impedes communication is if you've quit and stayed. So you're in a job you hate, the best of you can't show up. Move somewhere where you won't hate that job, and you'll have far better communication skills there.
Yeah, I think they hit on them. I mean, some of it's going to depend on the job, right? Some soft skills are going to be more important in one job versus another. But I think really just, you know, that dependability, I think that positive attitude is going to come into play in any job. And then definitely communication and problem solving.
Thank you.
Anybody else have a question? Okay, one last question before we wrap things up that I had. Were soft skills, like you guys discussed, are the employee's ability to resolve conflict, problem solve, those kinds of things. How does a new employee, either before they are hired or after, find out what soft skills are important to your organization and what culture is created at your work environment?
If I was to say important ones are honesty, transparency, ethics. You know, our whole company is built on great business ethics, and we want everybody else to follow that. And we know that not everybody, you know, is going to be the same, but it's kind of what we look for. And it might be a question that you get asked when you're interviewing, give you an example of something and what would you do? What would be your choice, you know, in where you say had an opportunity to make a lot of money, or you had an opportunity to do the right thing business wise, where you could retain a customer for a long time rather than making a quick buck from them or something like that. Obviously, the correct answer for us would be we want to do it right, and we want to retain that customer for a long time and make them a partner with us in business. So I think that transparency, ethics are definitely good. Teamwork, leadership, you know, when you get into leadership is, because a leader can make or break another person in their job. And, you know, if you go into work every day and you have a manager who you don't like, you don't respect, you're not going to stay in that job for very long, and you're not going to do very well when you're in the job. So if you get, when you get to the stage where you're in leadership roles, remember that and look after the people that you are leading.
In our organization, we have what we call focus values, and those kind of, I mean, it's about respect, owning the moment, so taking accountability, and seizing opportunities, looking for ways to improve, champion excellence, always trying to strive to be your best. I think that helps us build our culture, and those are the things that we're looking for, and that we, when we do phone interviews, we're kind of screening for those types of things as well.
I think the other thing, depending on the level of the interview, you can ask, what kind of culture does your company have? What typical measurements do you use? Do you have employee engagement surveys? Because it's perfectly okay to figure out as much about the company that you want to go work for before you start spending your life there. So I would say ask. And also, often we will have someone in that same role available for the person to talk to when we give them a tour of the company. We'll show them where they would work. So the more information you can find out, the better decision you can make.
Yeah, I would say most companies are going to have a mission and a vision statement, right? That kind of outlines, you know, what they're looking for. So that can kind of help to guide you. But I also think it's just asking questions, right? When I start a new job and I have a new boss, it's, you know, what kind of communication do you like? You know, do you like a lot of communication? Do you like not very much communication? Do you prefer a text? Do you prefer an email? And so really, it's just asking those questions and getting to know them. And I think really, once you start a new job, that culture, I mean, it comes out pretty quickly. and so you'll realize whether it's a good fit for you or not, or, you know, kind of how the pecking order is within that organization.
Perfect. Any final concluding thoughts or anything from our panelists that you'd like to add about the conversation about soft skills for our students today?
I think you mentioned it. It's soft skills are one of those things that you just have to kind of keep improving. There's so many things on the internet, if nothing else. Just go do a Google search on soft skills, or, you know I'm weak in this area. How can I improve that, right? I will tell you, I hated public speaking. Hated. I stood in front of my college class and shook. And I knew that was something that I was going to need as I continued to move up. And so, you know, I just challenged myself to get into those situations where I would do more public speaking. And the more you do it, the more you get used to it. And I think a lot of the soft skills are like that. The more you do them, the more you use them, the better you get at them.
All right. Well, thank you so much to our panelists that took time out of their busy day today to come give us their expert opinion and knowledge, share their knowledge, and thank you yourselves to being here and gaining knowledge on your future employment. Best of luck.